Let's visit the 90s all over again. Put on those hammer pants. This is Dope Nostalgia.
Welcome, everybody, to episode 126 of Dope Nostalgia. This is the second part of a two-parter on the boy band 2ge+her, who came out in the early 2000s. So it just bleeds over a little bit out of the 90s, and it fits on the show great. And on top of that, we did a great episode about them in part one with our friends from No More Late Fees podcast, Jackie and Danielle. And then I reached out to the guys, and Evan Farmer, who played Jerry O'Keefe, was happy to come on the show and tell us all about his experiences while he was doing 2ge+her. And he lets us know what he's been up to in the recent years as well. And he's such a nice guy. It was a really enjoyable chat, and I'm happy to share it with you now. Before we do that, here's a little bit of taste of some of the music from 2ge+her.
We're alone in the room, playing and now you're telling me goodbye. So you want us apart, that puts a knife in my heart and a tear welling up in my eye.
One little tear.
But let me remind you how much you have been blind to. You've totally changed me, mix me up, rearrange me. My hair how you like, quit hanging with Mike. And now you repaint me.
Time today, Evan. I appreciate it.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I'm flattered you reached out.
Okay, so on Dope Nostalgia Podcast, we talk about what happened in the 90s as well as what you're doing now. So it's a good mix of the two, and yeah, we'll go from there.
You're expecting me to remember the 90s is what you're saying.
Okay, you were kind of like the 2ge+her thing was very much 2000s, wasn't it? Like 99 2000.
Let's see. I think we shot in either 98 or 99, mm-hmm. somewhere right in there. And then the film, and then the series started 2000. So yeah, it was kind of across the Y2K time period.
Yeah. So I'm cool with like things that happened in the early 2000s, because so much of it started in the 90s. And I mean, the boy band thing was huge for me and a lot of our listeners. So when you guys set out to do 2ge+her, was it to be a parody originally? Was that the idea? Or was there a point where you all felt we're an actual band now?
So I got the script through my agent, and it was just a regular movie audition. The script was brilliantly written. The Gunn cousins, the whole dynasty of the Gunn family, they're writers. Yeah. Movies, they're the who's who of a lot of the hit movies. But the cousin, it was just, I think their big foray, Mark and Brian Gunn, and I thought it was one of the funniest things I ever read. And ironically, I was doing theater at the time. I was doing The Fantastics off Broadway, and nice. I remember my agent had just moved offices. The script came to me late. It was very 11th hour, and I was really debating whether or not I had the energy to do the audition. They wanted me to put myself on tape, which back then you always came into the agency office to do that. And they had a facility for that. And I was like, really, I've got to tape myself. And I remember a friend of mine was like, just do it. I'll help you. So we literally went to an abandoned building above, which is the space above the theater before a show. Did one take of the audition scene, and I think I had to sing a song. I want to say I sang It's So Hard to Say Goodbye to Yesterday, Boys to Men, or I might be getting a couple of them confused. No Diggity. classic '90s so good. Song. Set the tape off, and then I don't want to say I forgot about it, but you know, at that kind of stage of my life, I was just kind of doing, it's a numbers game, and I was doing a million things at once. And then all of a sudden I remember, things happened really fast. Sorry, I'm kind of reliving it. I really haven't thought about a lot of this. And then I got really lucky and booked my first big film, which was Shaft. And I was playing one of Christian Bale's obnoxious Upper East Side friends in the opening scene with Mekhi Phifer and Samuel Jackson. And it was all very overwhelming. But I remember I was sitting on set of Shaft, and my agent called and was like, hey, you got the part in this Together thing, and it's going to be a big deal. It's MTV's first made for TV movie. It's the Spinal Tap of boy bands, which is essentially the question that you asked. I'm sorry, kind of long-winded, but it was designed to be the Spinal Tap mockumentary, very much like Spinal Tap, but of boy bands, which of course was the biggest thing at the time.
Yeah.
And so I actually, I left shooting Shaft and went straight to Vancouver, and we shot the film, I believe, in like 3 weeks. And then we kind of all just sat back and we're like, is this thing going to happen and be a big deal or not? And then when it aired, it was such art imitating itself. We manufactured this big premiere for a real band. So the way they marketed us was very much on both sides. The pretending that we were a real band, all the while we were making a band, or making fun of boy bands in the mockumentary format, so to speak. It was also, I say making fun of, but it was very much a loving tribute at the same time. Yeah. It's very weird. It was everything all at once, you know?
Yeah.
And then it turned into a TV series. The success of the movie, they called, and I almost didn't do the series. The film had opened some doors for me, and I was really seriously considering some other options. And MTV is not known for paying people very well. And so they assumed I was turning down because of the low money, and I was not. So eventually they brought up the money, and I was like, okay, I'd be stupid not to take this. So that's how the series kind of happened. And the rest, as they say, is history.
Yeah. Were there any, I'm glad that you're getting a chance to, you know, talk. It's been a while. Hey, you haven't done any interviews about Together in a while.
I don't do a lot about them. No. And you know, it's so funny because I've changed careers so many times since Together. I became a TV host. I did my own radio show. I've done so many different things that it's, and again, it's been 22 years, something like that.
It's hard to imagine.
I've had children since then. Yeah.
We're definitely going to be talking about the shows that you're on now and what's going on. I wanted to ask,
a short conversation because I'm not doing anything right now. So we can cut to the chase there.
Were there any similarities between you and your character, Jerry?
Yeah, it's funny because again, I haven't thought about this in such a long time. And my character, Jerry, was, you know, As a whole, we're all kind of playing very sort of naive, dumbed down versions of human beings, as lots of comedy is written that way. But my character, I very much interpreted as this overly caffeinated, intense, you know, taking everything so seriously. And that was very much me back then. And so even the way we shot and the intensity with which I took everything so seriously. It's kind of one of my regrets too. I wish I enjoyed myself a little bit more, but yeah, that definitely came out in the character of Jerry. At the time I was, you know, my character arc was very much mirroring a lot of what was going on in my real life. And so, you know, because we were so close as a group with the guns and the production team, we all are very much like a family. Like, I think a lot of our lives were sort of, you know, the storylines were kind of pulled directly. So, I mean, it's now that I think back on it, there was a lot more that was very much reflective of what was going on. I'm definitely very much a Jack Tripper. Now that's an old one.
Well, I remember, you know, Jack Tripper.
May he rest in peace. Yes. Love him. So I very much, I think he was an inspiration, a lot of physical comedy. That was big. Kevin Farley was also really big into the physical comedy. So mm-hmm. I think he and I kind of ramped each other up in a lot of those, in a lot of that way. But yeah, I would definitely say there was a lot of me. And you know, what's funny is I always considered myself a musician, but by today's standards, I mean, I can't even believe I got the job. I mean, I can't even believe on so many levels, because I'm not a fantastic singer. Noah was an amazing singer. He played Chad. Mm-hmm. Alex, gifted musician on so many levels. I mean, I can strum a guitar and I can, you know, keep tune for the most part. But yeah, it was neat. And there was so much of that aspect of it where we were a manufactured group, though it was for a movie. It was very much the same way a lot of the boy bands at the time were sort of being manufactured. And you had your, this is gonna be hard to touch on without making somebody feel bad, but you had your Justin Timberlakes, who yeah. was like a vocal phenom, you know? And then, you know, you had other people who filled out different characters needed for the group dynamic, you know, but maybe yeah. the vocal gymnastics wasn't their absolute forte. So, you know, I think my character was modeled after maybe a Justin Timberlake, but I certainly was not the vocal phenom of the group. But it was fun. It was great. It was like I got to live out a fantasy, literally from bartending to 2 weeks later, my entire life was upended and my world changed, and playing arenas and doing weird, crazy stuff that you kind of only dream of doing. And then I got to go back to normal again, which is great, too.
What an experience to have had. Did you guys do all the filming in Canada, in Vancouver, or just the movie?
We did all of it. In fact, I went and looked at a map of where we were. I was trying to figure out where our studio was. So I lived right off of Stanley Park, which is kind of where all the, they put everybody who's doing film production in Vancouver. And then I remember we would have to drive, I think it was Burnaby yeah. or something like that. To the studio every morning at like 4 o'clock in the morning. But yeah, everything was shot there. We did our second music video there. The hardest part of breaking up is getting back your stuff. But then like
favorite,
a weekend.
That's my favorite song of all the Together songs. It's brilliant.
Is it?
Yeah.
I think I heard you put it on one of your games, which I have children, so I can't use the F word. They're in earshot, but where you played it on episode 40, I think, and nobody could figure it out.
Yes.
They went through all the boy bands. Yes. It was like insane. And I was like, I'm so flattered. And then they're like, Backstreet. And then, you know, I was like, well, no, that was us. That was us.
Yeah.
That was a fun one. That was a fun one. The car, video was the used car salesman theme, which was hilarious. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we were just all along, you know, for the ride. It was so chaotic and so much, 7 days of work constantly for, I don't know, 2 years straight with no break. And, you know, if we weren't filming the show, we were touring. And if we weren't touring, we were shooting music videos. If we weren't shooting music videos, we were promoting. I think we were a little bit used up, but that's why I don't remember it. I mean, it was so much happened in such a tiny short period of time that so many things, I'm just like, oh my God. There were episodes. I don't own any of the episodes. In fact, they didn't give them to us. But yeah. I undug a couple of videotapes from my mom's collection before, right after she passed, and I was watching them, and I was like, I don't remember shooting this episode. I literally was watching it as if it was eyes for the first time. That's how tired I think we all were. It was wild. Yeah.
Well, they say that that's what happens when something like is that heightened in your career, and especially at a young age, it's kind of a whirlwind. So you're not alone on that. I think a lot of people, entertainers, have gone through that.
It's probably a term for that. Something like, first job amnesia or something like that. I don't know.
You know, it took me forever to catch on to the QT's last name mashup of Mick and Knight. And I was like thinking about it a week ago. I'm like, Mick, is that supposed to be a play on McIntyre and Knight? Most likely.
Yeah.
I love that.
So, fun fact, Jerry O'Keefe was originally Jerry King, but there was a an actual touring artist with Jerry King, and there was a copyright infringement on their name or whatever. We couldn't use it. So my chair back, you know, for the filming said Jerry King on it. and then they had to change it. Yeah. To Jerry O'Keefe. It's kind of funny. And then I made them make me a new one, because I was like, come on. And so I've got both in shadow boxes now somewhere. I know, actually they all burned. I had a house fire in 2005, but, it was not Jerry O'Keefe. And I don't know where O'Keefe came from. There's probably a lot of things that I probably didn't pick up on that the fans know that were built into the show. Because the Guns were really clever that way. They were really, really good at picking up minutiae and embedding things in there.
Yeah. It'll be interesting. Like, I bet you there's a lot of the Easter eggs that the fans notice too. There's this Together episode is actually going to be a two-parter, because I spoke with some ladies from another podcast and we talked about the show. And then I got a hold of you. So it'll be interesting to see what they have to say. Now, how did Kevin Farley get involved? Some folks don't realize that he's Chris's brother. And I don't know how you can't realize that, but yeah.
So Kevin was, I was the last one hired. So it was very 11th hour. So like I said, as soon as I got the job, I flew out the next day. Kevin, I think that everybody auditioned the same way. He might've had a little bit more of like, hey, you should talk to Kevin. He wasn't a complete unknown. He had been in a lot of Chris's movies, and, mm-hmm. And it's, tragically, Chris had passed away the year before we started filming. So a lot of that was really, really raw. And it was really difficult to watch, you know, him have to cope with something so, so tragic. And, you know, you see a lot of Chris in him, but I don't think what people realize is that's not really fair, because Kevin and Chris growing up together created a lot of the shtick that Chris went on to make famous. And so, you know, if he does anything that resembles Chris's material, you know, it's, oh, Kevin's doing Chris. No, it was actually a lot of what Chris did was Kevinisms, and they were very much equal partners in that. Chris just started his career much earlier, and you know, I'm not saying that Chris wasn't a genius, of course he was, but so is Kevin. And it really came out. There was one episode that I do remember where Kevin had the opportunity to play his own twin brother. And so, you know, where he would play two characters and they would shoot it, you know, one direction, he'd change clothes, reset up, and he'd literally have conversations with himself. And you really saw his genius come out when you could see him do something like that. But I do remember on set almost all the time, all of us were trying to make each other laugh. It was just a very funny vibe, high energy vibe. Kevin was always stirring up the kids, as I used to call it, because he was so much older than everybody else. Yeah. I mean, heck, I was 30 playing, you know, a 17-year-old. I don't even know what Jerry's birthday. It was on the, I'm looking around because I think there is a doll somewhere and they have a fake birthday on there. And I don't remember how old they tried to make me. But yeah, it was weird. You know, I was 30 playing a child. And that also informed my experience when we were out touring, because all the bands of that time were actually pretty close in age to Noah and Alex, who were in our band, and they were all really young. I'd graduated college. I had, you know, been out in New York living my life for, you know, a good 5 years, and then this happened. And so I kind of had a very different viewpoint, almost paternal in a way. I think that also goes along with my personality as being overly intense, being overly taking things too seriously, which I've since rid myself of. Kids will do that to you. But yeah, it was really kind of interesting. I didn't envelop myself into the moment as much, because I think there was so much of like worry that I expressed or felt about the sudden money, the sudden attention, the sudden of everything, that I went very, very much cautiously towards it. And I was worried that those who weren't very, very cautious about it were going to get into trouble. And it was very surreal. That was a very weird tangent that I just took. But again, this is all nostalgic for me, because I really haven't thought about it.
Yeah, no. And I think that's a natural reaction too, especially at the age you were at. It was like, okay, so where is this actually going to go? Because you're thinking about your future at the same time, right? Yeah. I think 30 is pretty classic age for that.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a late stage game, but I wouldn't trade it for the world. I mean, I think it made it easier for me to transition away. I'll tell you that. Mm-hmm. Just to kind of see it for what it was and see it for the moment. I think I was so busy trying not to get lost in the moment that I missed a lot of it, you know, as far as, you know, really kind of sitting back and smelling the roses. Mm. But, you know, there's time for that. We hope.
That's the nice thing about later afterwards. You realize, oh, you kind of take in every moment a little bit differently, right?
100%. Yeah. 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 My life has been very much, if I started my intensity journey in my late 20s, it is just, I've been mellowing out ever since. So it's good. It's good that it all happened. It was fun.
The Britney Spears tour. Now, how much of that do you remember?
Where she did it again? I remember all of it, and it was actually played up. Our participation in her tour, I'll be the first to confess it right now, was far less than what I think it was marketed as. MTV, they're marketing geniuses. That's what our whole show was about, was a play on how you can market anything or anybody into reality. Mm. You can, it's the Ricky story or Ricky Martin. Yeah. Ricky Martin story. You know, we're like, we're going to take this young kid and make him a star. And then they did, you know, and you can do that with boy bands too. So when we toured with Britney, we were very much the side stage where people sat on bales of hay as they came way too early to a Britney Spears concert that wasn't going to start for another 2 hours. So we met Britney, we were backstage with Britney, a couple of times, but for the most part, we were kind of like the circus sideshow act way before it started. But it was definitely an honor, because I tell you, she is one of the hardest working artists that I've met then or since. I've never met anybody who was that on top of her game at the time. And it's easy to see why. I think the stress, you can see what happens when you're working 18 hours a day at that level of intensity. Kind of bringing it all back full circle to my intensity journey. It's, you know, you got to learn to chill out, but I have mad respect for her and her skills. And, it was fun. And I do remember one incident where our mics went out. So we would sing to track. We weren't lip syncing. And we could actually pull it off, I would say, plausibly. We weren't winning any, you know, harmony vocal competitions, but we were the fun, entertaining show. And I remember our tracks completely went out, just like it did in the movie. There was a scene, I think, at a spelling bee in the very early in the movie where Doug, I guess, was his character's name, basically tries to carry the show without any music. We all walk off stage and he's out there. But the same thing happened for real on stage. Our tracks went out and we just kept going. And, you know, the crowd loved it. And we just completely riffed and pulled it off somehow miraculously. And I think that was probably our crowning achievement of all time. But we had, you know what, the best concerts we did were the radio tours. I had no idea what a radio tour was until we were doing them. Mm. And I remember Jones Beach Amphitheater. It's got to be like 20,000 people at this place. And we were headlining this radio tour, which meant that like Enrique Iglesias was going on before us and opening up. It was just very bizarre to go from complete obscurity in a couple of months. I mean, really, we're talking super compressed time frame to all of a sudden we would start calculus with our backs turned to the audience. And as each one of us sang, we would turn around as our first time to, and my character was the first one to sing. And I remember I turned around and really saw the crowd staring up truly at the first time. Cause when you run out on stage, you're just like, get in position. Yeah. And, and they were all singing my words, and I almost couldn't function. I just tears. And like, that will forever be one of the greatest moments of my life. I can only imagine how that must be if I had written that song, like if I was a musician that had written this heartfelt song and had people singing back to me my words at a concert. I've got a good friend here in Tennessee who's a pretty big name celebrity of the same time, musician, and he writes those kinds of songs. And I just look at him with awe. I'm like, I can't believe you get to do that every single night. And So those were probably the more impactful moments, and, you know, kind of bumping elbows with Destiny's Child before they became the big thing. And it was a real big moment in history where people were exploding. And I was like, we were all these little planted seeds in the bed, and we were just sprouting. And the machine just took off and ran with so many of them. So that was those good memories.
The excitement. Oh, wow. Yeah. A lot of cool experiences for sure. And that kind of segues good into the next question, where I'm talking about the writing, because I understand that you did a fair amount of the writing, and these songs are literally great pop music. I think they're written very well. How much did you have to do with the writing?
So I wrote one song on the first album. Alex wrote one song on the first album. I guess what I co-wrote. But MTV didn't realize this was going to be, you know, a big success, and would spawn a second album. So by the time we got to album number two, they were like, look, you can help and contribute all you want. We're not giving you any credits. Because at that point in time, there was a label in the mix, and they were reaching their hands in to get their chunk of the money. And MTV had their own, you know, production for the music, and they wanted their piece. And we sold, we printed over 1 million albums total. And to give you an idea of how it worked back then, I maybe saw $3,000 to $5,000 from all those albums total. The vast majority of that was ASCAP, because I had written on the first album. So that's how it works. And it was a lot of hands in the cookie jar. But so on the second album, you know, of course, we were all green, and, you know, none of us had any leverage to kind of change the dynamic of what was going on. And I'm not complaining. I think it was wrong, but I'm not saying I wouldn't do it again. But we would sit in the studio with these amazing producers, Josh and Brian from KNS, and Veit Ren, and all these. They were Britney's producers, NSYNC's producers, and we would. A lot of the songs actually were cut, like Britney cuts or NSYNC cuts, that we would then have to make fun or turn around and make funny. Ones that didn't land on their finished albums. It was, you know, if they, you know, are going to do it now, they'll record, like, you know, sometimes 30, 40 more songs, and just the ones that didn't make it, we would turn around. There was one like "I Want to Know Your Name," which was a Britney song. We're like, how do we make this funny? And we just would sit around and just make ourselves giggle with rewriting the lyrics, you know, should I let my package go, you know, stuff like that. You know, Kevin was great at that. So it really was collaborative. And I think that also helped a lot of the buy-in, you know, even though it wasn't, you know, we weren't going to see a ton of money, you know, from it. I think when we did do the series, we all felt a far bigger piece of ownership of each episode that we would do, because, you know, like the Monkees, every episode would be based around one of the songs that we put on the album. And that's how we would, you know, wrap up the storyline or whatever. So, you know, with the concert at the end and a neat little package. But that was probably the part I enjoyed the most, was participating in the creation of those things, because, you know, we didn't really ad lib in the acting at all. Most of it was just so well written that it didn't need it. And nor would it, I think, in the time frame that we had to shoot, would it have worked. It was funny, we were shooting the movie at the same time they were doing Best in Show, that movie, and they were staying at the same hotel in Vancouver, and they're 100% ad-libbed. And of course, that's Best in Show was Christopher Guest, yeah, who did Spinal Tap. Mm-hmm. It was a weird, was it Christopher Guest? Gosh, I'm
Well, I remember the title of the movie, but I don't remember much more about it. So
they would literally go into these rehearsal rooms. Oh, you got to go watch Fred Lillard. And oh my gosh, it was so great. But then we go into the rehearsal. We'd be in a rehearsal room in the hotel learning dance moves. And then we'd go out in the hall to kind of take a break, and we could hear them ad-libbing scenes to try to come up for the next day's shooting. And it was amazing. It was absolutely, it was astounding to, to kind of be a fly on the wall for some of that. And but that's how Spinal Tap was created, right? So it was, here we were, the next iteration of it across the room with, the guy who created Spinal Tap. Very, very surreal. Yeah. Very neat. I never really put the two together. I knew that Best in Show was there, but I never really put the Spinal Tap preview to that whole thing. Sorry, I'm rambling.
No, you're good. But, and I'm glad you brought up the monkeys too, because that was something I was thinking. Did you guys take anything from what they had already done, or think about even what they had already done while doing this show?
I'd like to say yes, but I think Kevin and I were the only ones old enough to even remember what the monkeys were, So I'm sure the writers probably did a lot of that sort of background study of what works in this genre and how to do it. But no, I know that's actually a good excuse to go back and watch the monkeys episodes with a new appreciation for sure.
Put a spell on me. Then you walked into the room. Yeah. Oh, what to do? Should I let my package show? Or should I try and play it cool? I've been pulling, I've been playing for so long. My heart's been waiting. Finally love someone like you. Message.
Voicemail number just for you.
Give us a call at Dope Nostalgia. Our number is 780-851-8785.
Leave us a message. Pick up the phone just like you used to in the old days. Remember before text messaging? Yeah, we used to actually call each other.
If you just want to be heard and be on the podcast, give us a call. Once again, our Dope Nostalgia hotline, 780-851-8785. Pick up the phone.
Remember, this number is Canadian, so long-distance charges may apply.
Hey, I'm Josh Rodriguez.
And I'm Mike Zacchio.
And we are
the new pod on the block.
Every week, Mike and I will be breaking down our obsession with everything boy band culture.
From bangers to bops to fashion and everything in between.
If it's boy band related, we've got you covered.
We also want you to be a part of it. So call to our hotline and leave a voicemail for the show.
818-308-4084.
Be sure to subscribe, give us 5 stars, and leave us a review.
Follow me at Mike_Zacchio.
And I'm Josh Rodriguez at Josh_Rodriguez_.
And you can follow New Pod on the Block on Instagram at
New Pod on the Block. New Pod on the Block, every week on your favorite podcast platform.
Come on, Jerry, focus, focus.
Interviews. Very important. Okay?
Just imagine I'm a reporter for Just for Teens magazine, okay? I come up to you and I ask, what's your favorite color? QT?
Blue.
Jerry?
Blue.
No, that's QT's favorite color.
It's mine too.
No, there can't be any overlap. Oh, come on, think. Say some girl picks up a copy of the magazine and she reads that both Jerry and QT's favorite color is blue. Her favorite color is green. But nobody in Together likes green. Ergo, nobody in Together likes her. Ergo, she has no personality, no taste. She's worse than nothing. She's a waste of human flesh. Come on, guys, think. Here's a little song I wrote for a band called Whoa. You know what they did with it? Kelly Mize wiped his ass with it. That's what. Yeah. Not for you guys.
Say it. Don't spray it. I want the news. Not the weather.
Jerry, favorite color?
I don't know, blue. It's been blue. Since forever. Since before QT was born, even.
Mr. Boss, I'll change my favorite color.
Great. QT's new favorite color?
A robin's egg blue.
Uh-uh. You best back up, bitch. Robin's egg blue, yo, that's my color, homie. Hey, this is my house. Hey, no, it's my house.
Now, the loss of Michael, I know it hit the fans hard, as I imagine it was really difficult for all of you guys as well. And how has his memory and legacy been kept alive since it's been so many years?
Yeah, that was... Michael was... He was one of the most incredible human beings. You know, there's a lot of, when people pass too soon, regardless of who they were, or what they represented in life, you know, there's, they get a lot of, credit, you know, and I don't know really how to say this. Michael was everything that they said about him. And then a little bit more. He was truly a living angel, and he lived it every day. I feel so unbelievably blessed and lucky to have been in his atmosphere. He had survived and dealt with so much in his life, and I never saw him complain once. And let me tell you, there was a lot of complaining in that whole entertainment world, and he was just such a standout. Such pure joy and energy. And he was so unbelievably talented. That kid could write. He had one functioning lung. His diaphragm was paralyzed the whole time. And he's kicking out songs and recording, keeping up with the rest of us. And it was always terrifying when we would go out on tour, because we were required, or they demanded that we put on a full show. And that was hard for a healthy 30-year-old in the best shape of my life, not somebody who is, you know, been through what he had been through with Hodgkin's lymphoma and the radiation and all that stuff. It was mind-blowing that he did it and took care of his family emotionally. I mean, he really was their support system, because they were suffering because he was suffering, if that makes sense. And
yeah,
he was the stand-up guy. He was taking care of everybody the whole time, and he still is in a lot of ways. And to answer your question about his legacy, so he has the Michael Cuccioni Foundation, which raises money for children basically in the same circumstances. He's profoundly affected so many other charities. In fact, the year before he passed, he was named Vancouver's Man of the Year. Quite an accolade, since he died before, well, right after 16th birthday. And I, right after, for the first year or two, I would do a lot of charity type concerts, working with his mom, Gloria. Sadly, we've lost somewhat of touch. We usually reach out every 2 or 3 years, but, you know, time will do that. But yeah, man, he was pretty special. He was probably the highlight of the whole Together experience.
I bet. And like, I'm sorry that you guys had to go through so much, but I think like he's just been so inspiring to so many. And I think that's, it's important that all of us try to, you know, keep his legacy alive throughout So we'll be sharing some links to the foundation so people can get involved.
Good, good. Yeah. Lots to smile about.
Yeah, that's the thing. Got to remember those good times and the things that put a smile on your face.
Yeah.
Now, who were you? Did you guys actually watch any of the boy bands that were going on at the time? Obviously, the big two, BSB and NSYNC, going back to like New Kids and everything. Did you guys have a favorite boy band?
We got along famously with NSYNC. We did some, I'm trying to think if we toured with them or we just did promotion with them. For some reason, we got paired with them a lot and they got it. They 100% were down with Together. They thought it was the funniest thing. We studied the boy bands, but we were also spending a lot of time with them. Backstreet Boys, we didn't really have a lot of interaction with, although I think they, you know, they respected it. There were, you know, a couple that saw us, I think, as a threat to some degree because they received the "we're making fun of you" angle and not the "we're tribute to you" angle. I think our storylines were undercutting in their minds, and maybe fairly so, all the hard work that they put into it, which is certainly not the way I saw our show. I mean, we were not saying, "Hey, look, anybody can do this." But I think there might have been a little bit of, you know, rub the wrong way. I do remember in New Jersey, Kevin, jokingly, of course, on a radio show, started a fight with the manager of 98 Degrees. That was really interesting. He was trying to challenge 98 Degrees in character to a cage fight. And saying that Michael could take all of them. Of course, you know, 98 Degrees, all these guys were heavy weightlifters, bodybuilder types, and, you know, good looking dudes. And, you know, so he was trying to get under the skin. I remember we got a nasty call from their manager while we were on air, which I thought was hilarious. But yeah, man, they were, you know, I love the whole boy band genre. I wasn't a big fan of boy band music going into it. But seeing it from the inside, you know, there's nothing you can take away from those guys. They work their tails off, talented. And it takes a lot to be in a room with four other dudes and not want to kill each other in that amount of pressure 24/7. And that's really what they're doing is they're throwing you in a pressure cooker, and saying, "Hey, if you can deal with all this torture, we'll give you a little bit of money. And you'll get to see the world." And, you know, it works out if it can work out. I don't know the inside scoop as to how well that's worked out in other bands. I know we fared okay. Yeah. We had our moments, but yeah, no, that was really neat. Yeah. NSYNC, I would say that was probably our brethren, if you will. And it's actually funny. Justin lives just up the street from my farm here in Nashville now, and his wife and their kids. So apple doesn't fall far from the tree.
Nice.
That doesn't even remotely work in this one. I don't even know where I was going with that. He's a good old country boy. Let me put it to you that way.
Man of the woods. That's right. That's JT.
His farm's much bigger than mine, though. Let me tell you, they did okay.
Now, segueing into what you did after the band, there was a time that you hosted TRL.
Yeah.
Guest hosting. Yeah. Tell us about how that happened.
That was actually a good story. So I was living in New York still, or I still had my place in New York, and we happened to be there. We had already done TRL. Carson had interviewed us a bunch of times, and I think, you know, our videos were rotating on the show. And he was doing that Cancun trip that they do every year, or did every year, with TRL. And I think it's the time he met and fell deeply in love or lust or whatever it was with someone in Cancun. I don't remember.
Tara Reid.
Tara Reid. It was Tara Reid.
Yeah.
And he didn't get on the plane to come home. And so they were going to, and now TRL was live, and they were scrambling to find somebody to host the show. And I guess they had gone down their roster of in-house talent and couldn't find anybody. I happened to be literally, 10 blocks away, and my agent's like, "Hey, would you do this?" And I was like, "I guess. I've never done anything like this." Physically ran because I couldn't afford the time. I mean, it was like, we went live at 3. I mean, this was like 2:48. And so I'm running up the street in my street clothes, get to 1515 Broadway, which is where MTV is. And going up the escalator, they're sticking an IFB in my ear. They're handing me a microphone. I've got cue card guy on the top of the escalator. He's like, "This is how we're going to do it. And you're going to do this. And you're going to do that." And I'm like, "And by the way, you're going to interview Madonna." And I'm like, "What?
What? No way."
It was so much at once that I was like, okay, I didn't have time to get nervous. So I literally was walking into the studio as they were counting the live clock in, and boom, and I literally grabbed the mic, turned around, and that was the first time I'd ever done anything hosting. And that was when I was like, this is what I want to do. It was the energy, the thinking on your feet, the constant engagement, the excitement. There was no sit and wait in your trailer for 30 minutes while they relight the setup and you come in and act for 5. It was what I was born to do. And so from that point on, I had to kind of fill my, and I did some more acting after that, but I was really kind of like, wow, if I can't get one of those jobs, I don't really want to do entertainment anymore. And so I had actually decided to quit acting. I just shot the last film I ever did was Austin Powers. And I told my agent, I'm like, "Hey, I'm out." And I literally even moved away from California, went back to New York, and I was kind of minding my own business. And then While You're Out, which was a show on TLC, a home makeover show. One of the first, there was Bob Vila, which was a how-to show. Then there was Trading Spaces, which broke ground as being an entertainment home makeover show. Mm-hmm. And then the third one was ours, While You're Out, and they were looking for a replacement host. And all of a sudden I'm like, wait a minute, that thing I really love to do. And building, which is what I do, went to school for architecture. I was never meant to be in this industry, I don't think. So anyway, I kind of put two and two together and then kind of jumped ship and went into the world of hosting. So it's a weird transition to make, isn't it? From boy band to carpenter host.
I love how you've taken the two things that you enjoy so much and put them together. I think that's the dream right there, with the carpentry. I think, wouldn't that be, you and John Knight should do a show together.
That would be fun.
Because now he's got Farmhouse Fixer.
Yeah.
That'd be cool if you guys pulled off a few episodes together or something like that.
Well, I'll throw this out there. I'm willing to do an episode. I'm not sure I'm willing to do a full show anymore. I got a pretty cush job as dad right now. So I'm digging on that. But the entertainment world is not really super conducive when, you got to hustle. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of playing time away from home time that as soon as I had my second son, I realized I can't do it. And so I was actually doing, I was hosting a music show, basically VJ type show for country music television here in Nashville, 2010 to 2013. And then my second son was born in 2012, and they were flying me all over the place. And it was a lot of fun. I was interviewing lots of really interesting, neat people. So it was another kind of combination of things I love to do, but I just couldn't do it, be on an airplane away. So my contract was up in 2013, and I walked away and I hadn't looked back really. There's been a couple things where I've just dabbled, like guest star type stuff, but I'm not interested in the 18-hour days and, the got to be here, in Chicago tomorrow or whatever it was. So it's nice. I think all of this was a journey to find my true calling. Maybe that's what it was.
Dad, it's nice that you found such a great balance. I think that's the dream. So we're happy for you. I think that's great.
I've been lucky, I haven't had to, kind of jump back into the fray and Maybe when this is all, this parenting thing is all over and they've flown the coop, I got at least 8 more years on that. You know, maybe I'll do a little bit more and kind of hit my creative niche. But for now, I've been doing a lot of building. That's kind of where I get my creative outlet. The barn built. I've got a farm shop that I'm finishing building out in Leaper's Fork here in Tennessee. And that's going to be my business headquarters where I create custom building and cooking experiences. We had to kind of shutter for COVID, but we hope to reopen relatively soon.
Great. And people can find your information about it on Instagram, on your Instagram, right? So that if they wanted to check it out.
Yeah, I'm terrible at social media. I'll tell you that right now. I post a couple pictures here and there. I don't think I've posted a Twitter in, I don't know, 10 years. But yeah, the Building Barn, we've got our own website. Again, it's not really fully functioning right now. I bought the farm just before COVID. Mm. And since we weren't taking any clients, we used to rent a local farm. Since we weren't taking any clients for that period of time, I just kind of hung back and been slowly building the farm or the barn out for the business. But yeah, we'll see. Again, it's kind of like, you know, I'm the relaxed guy now. I'm not the super overly intense guy now. So I'm like, whatever, we'll see what happens.
Are you still in touch with the guys from the group?
Every once in a while, I see Kevin would come to Nashville. He was shooting a show here for a while, so I would see him every once in a while. Alex and I touch base quite a bit. I've tried to get a hold of Noah so many different times, but he's changed his number. I don't know. Mm-hmm. The guns occasionally, but not, you know, not so much. There was the idea to do some form of reunion. I think this was when I was still at CMT, and we tried to cobble something together. And every once in a while, Alex, who's still hustling, God bless him, he'll get us a gig, and he'll try to talk us all into joining to show up playing with O-Town or something like that. And yeah. I'm like, dude, I just can't. I don't have the energy for that anymore. And we'd have to rehearse and we'd have to do all that stuff. It just sounds so tiring. All that being said, I think if the right opportunity popped up and made it doable for us, but I can't hit the road. So, you've just reminded me that there's a lot of people I need to reach out to. I need to reach out to Michael's mom again and the guys and just kind of say hi. I don't know. You might've had more luck getting a hold of them than I have.
No.
It's tough.
Well, it's life. It's like that with anything. The people that you hung out with like 20 years ago are sometimes not, you know, they're off doing their own things. So it's just how it works out for everybody.
And yeah, I get to watch vicariously. What's that?
Go ahead. Finish what you were saying. I'm sorry.
Well, I just get that, you know, I enjoy seeing them. Like, you know, Alex still works pretty regularly. So I'll just be watching TV and, you know, with my kids and all of a sudden there's Alex and, you know, same thing with Kevin. I think Noah kind of, you know, is taking a break, doing his own thing, but, it's nice to see them continuing to do what they love. So talented that, you know, it'd be a waste if they didn't.
Mm-hmm. No, that's the thing. And you're in a happy place and I'm really hoping the same for the rest of the guys. Have you ever considered doing your own podcast? 'Cause you can kind of just do it whenever you want.
Not with folks like you who do it so well.
You'd be great.
It's a crowded space. It's a crowded space. I don't feel like I have a whole lot to say that I haven't said. I wrote a book which pretty much said just about everything that I felt like I needed to. I wrote a book for my kids, which was never meant to be published. And it was just basically, you know, I watched that movie where the dad finds out he's terminal and his son isn't even born yet. Really sad movie. I think Tom Hanks was in it. I can't remember it, but it really messed me up. And so he had left these notes for his kid, right? And, you know, like, don't shave like this, shave like this. And it was really kind of cute, touching. It might've been, you know, very Hallmarky in some ways, but so I just, you know, I got this right after my first son was born. I was like, I got to write everything down. You know, I don't know. Wasn't necessarily I had the sense of doom, but I was just like, I got to do it. And then I was kind of piecing it together and talking to a friend of mine who's a literary agent. They're like, hey, yeah, let me take a look at that. It'd be really interesting. And originally I was like, oh, I don't know how I feel about that. And then they're like, this would be actually pretty useful, because a lot of it was about how to hustle, as it turns out. It's the art of the hustle, basically, of how to get the job. Because I realized with very little talent, I managed to work in a lot of different careers that are very tough to break into. And so my gift or my talent is breaking in. I broke into movies. And I'm not an actor. I mean, I remember when I got to New York, going to auditions alongside of, oh my God, the who's who became, I'm trying to think, Primal Fear. Who was the Ed Norton?
Okay.
Ed Norton and Primal Fear. So he and I very much were typed very similarly. So we would read for the same parts. And I would just sit there and I'm like, why am I here? This guy, you could just look at him in the waiting room and be like, this guy's an actor. This guy knows what the hell he's doing. He knows what's up. And I just felt like I was some kind of imposter. But anyway, I digress. Not a great singer, but ended up doing a whole bunch of music stuff. I sound like Kermit the Frog. You can listen to my voice here and, you know, tell that, but somehow I ended up doing a radio show, you know? So I was like, well, if I was fighting all these, you know, challenges where I had to jump the hurdle of talent and still get in, what was I doing right? And I guess that's what my book was about. It's called Breaking In. And so in it, I kind of follow the trajectory of my career and just the things that I've learned along the way. I cite a lot of books. I'm a heavy reader. I love reading. But anyway, I really, this is the longest winded answer to, have you ever thought about doing a podcast in the world?
I love it.
But no, I think I've said that just about everything I need to say at this point, more than anybody really should listen to.
Well, I think you've done great at all the things that we've seen you in, and I'm really like impressed with your talents. So don't cut yourself short. You've done a great job.
I'm not complaining. I had fun, and every once in a while I'll make myself laugh, and that's all that matters. If I can pull that off from time to time, I can make my kids laugh. So I'm like, wow, I'm doing something right.
Exactly. And that's what matters the most is friends, family, things like that. So I thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me today, because like it was really exciting to have you on the show. And thanks
that
for listening to
pleasure.
The show.
I'm honored. No, you do a great job. What was I listening to? The NWA and Brad Frischetti's interview. That was solid. You know, we toured with LFO, not toured, but we did a show, and I want to say that was one of the most. We were playing a high school. Mm-hmm. It was very early, and I just remember those guys made such a huge impact. I mean, they were 100% legit. They were not buying into their own hype. They were just so excited for the opportunity to do what they love to do. And it was so infectious that I was just like, I get it. I totally get it. And it's just a real tragedy that that they lost Rich and Evan. But they're being well represented, and their honor and memory is being well represented as well by Frischetti. So anyway, great work, and keep doing what you're doing. I hope you continue to get great guests like that. I know you will.
Well, thank you, Evan. And thanks for being a great guest. And maybe we'll talk again sometime. That'd be awesome.
Hey, anytime. I'm here in my wife's office, as you can see.
Sweet. I like the
place
setup.
The
it looks great.
She's a photographer. Yeah. She's really, really, she's talented. So I get to live vicariously through that ability. So she can do things I never dreamed of. But yeah, I'm a lucky guy.
That's wonderful. And I wish you and your family all the best right now. And I'll give you a tag on social media. I know you might not see it, but when this comes out, I'll tag you and everything, and we'll go from there.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right, Evan.
Have a good one.
You too. Take care.
Bye. Bye.
Let's get to know each other better in a special way. I think about you, baby, each night and day.
But you're always hanging out with the girl next door. You do each other's makeup and so much more.
Friday.
For a second. You know, you can follow us on Twitter at NostalgiaDope, Instagram at Dope_nostalgia. Visit our website at www.dopenostalgia.com or pick up the phone and call us at 780-851-8785.
This podcast is licensed by SoCan because we believe that artists should be paid for their work.